Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is Triangulation, episode 206, Monday, June 29, 2015. Ted Cohen. This episode of Triangulation is brought to you by Prosper. Prosper is a peer-to-peer lending marketplace which connects people who are looking to borrow money with those who have the money to lend. Visit prosper.com/twit and receive a $50 Visa gift card when you get a loan. And by Ring Video Doorbell. With Ring, you can see and talk to anyone at your door from anywhere in the world using your smartphone. It's like caller ID for your home. Get $25 off the Ring Video Doorbell when you go to ring.com/triangulation. Hi, I'm Tonya Hall, and I am hosting Triangulation today in place of Leo Laporte, who is on vacation. Triangulation is the conversation we have with people in the industry who have done something really big. Maybe they've, they were part of history, they're doing something now, and they're really the most interesting people that we talk to, I think, at TWiT, besides reporters and journalists and that sort of thing. And today, our guest is in the music business. He is Ted Cohen. He's the managing director at Tag Strategic, and he is, among many other things, he consults on music as well as more. And welcome to the show, Ted.
Great to be here again. Thanks very much. Not to this show, but great to talk with you again. We did Mavericks the last time, which was a lot of fun.
We did. And you have great advice for musicians and people on all ends of the music spectrum about how to market their business today. That's an industry that has changed so much over even just the last year. I mean, what we're seeing today, and you and I were talking about this a little bit this morning, with all of the evolution of subscription music. But you started in the music business a long time ago with bands that people probably are very familiar with today. What was your first job in the music business?
My first job was working in a friend of mine hired me to be the assistant buyer, the co-buyer with him, at a chain of record stores out of Cleveland, Ohio, called Disc Records. And the interesting thing about it is I went from running a college radio station to working in this store, and I'd never worked in a record shop in my life. I'd actually never had a job before. So one of the things that I did was every Saturday, I went to one of our stores on the west side of Cleveland, and I would work behind the counter all day for free. I called up the manager, this guy named Mike Gee, and said, can I come in and work for you for free? I want to find out why people buy music. And so I did that for a year and learned a lot.
The radio business, I've had some background in radio. It's a lot has changed. The traditional radio that that's where we found out music before. I remember sitting in my bed as a little girl, you know, tuning into to radio to hear the pop songs and listening to, you know, the countdown, the top 40. A lot has changed between how we heard music and found out about music then versus today. What did you think about that back then? I mean, did you think this is the way that's going to always be? Did you have like some sort of vision for how music would be formed in the future?
Well, so I started out, I had the job in the retail store in Cleveland. I became friends with a few of the people at Columbia Records, which became Sony Music. And I was basically adopted. I was mentored by a couple guys, one named Steve Popovich, who went on to sign Meatloaf, the Bat Out of Hell album, which was still one of the biggest records of all time. And then the other was a guy named Frank DeLeo, who went on to manage Michael Jackson. And they basically took me under their wing and got me a job with Columbia. And I started doing local promotion. And as you say, it was all about going to the radio station, getting them to ideally play the records that you thought they should be playing. Sometimes it was a struggle. I was in Cincinnati, Ohio, and I had, as my territory, I had Columbus, Ohio, Dayton, Ohio, Indianapolis, Louisville, Kentucky, Lexington, Kentucky. And I would go promote records, but on the weekends, I'd go see bands. That was more fun for me. But I met a lot of really good people and continue to stay in touch with them. An interesting one is a guy named, this guy in Indianapolis by the name of Lee Masters. And he said, I hate Indianapolis. I want to get out of here. And he says, get me a job somewhere. So I introduced him to somebody in Louisville, Kentucky, a guy named Johnny Randolph at WAKY. Station was called Wacky. And Lee got the job there. He went on to start a station. He then went to New York and ran VH1, worked on MTV, changed his name back to his legal name, which is Jarl Mohn, M-O-H-N. And he's now the CEO and chairman of NPR. So I guess he turned out pretty good.
I would say so. NPR is incredible. In fact, certainly helped pioneer podcasting, really realized the evolution of what was changing. You've got a really strong background of consulting, including consulting at EMI Music for a little over six years. In May, I think, of 2000, you started with them. What was that experience like?
Well, I'll go through the history a little bit more just to give you a little bit of background. So, I'll give you the date. So in 71, I went to work for Columbia. In 72, I went to work for Warner Records. While I liked working with radio stations, as I said earlier, I loved live music more. And I started running away with the bands. And I mean, literally, Alice Cooper came to Cincinnati and I became friends with Shep Gordon, who, I don't know if you're familiar, they did a movie about him last year called Super Mensch that Mike Myers did. I became friends with Shep and with Alice Cooper, and they said, get on the plane. And so for like the next couple of years, I would sort of get in trouble for running away with the band. After that, they moved me into artist development in 74, which was running away with the band. That was my job. My job was to work with new groups to help them both with their live show, with their image. It was an elegant version of marketing and publicity and career development. And they moved me to Boston to do this job initially. And I met the people at Advent Speakers, and I met the people at DBX and a few other companies. And through a comedy of Zelig-like errors, I ended up in Chicago in 1977 at the Consumer Electronics Show, sitting in a room in a hotel suite at the Drake Hotel with the Advent people. They were demonstrating the first big screen TV, which was called the Advent Video Beam. And in walks these two scruffy guys, long hair, beards, carrying a zipper case. And inside, they said, they opened it up and they said, this is the Apple I computer. It's going to change the world. And they hooked it into the big screen, and they were showing color computer graphics on a 7-foot screen. And I got interested in technology. At the same time, while I was in Boston, I became friends with the folks at WBCN in Boston, WMMR in Philly, WHFS in Washington, stations I can't remember in Baltimore. Did a lot of live broadcasts. Did a lot of, in BCN they would call instant radio spectaculars. So we did Little Feat, we did Jimmy Cliff, we did Van Morrison, we did Pretenders, Robert Palmer. U2 did their first live show ever, their first performance in the U.S. at a club called The Paradise in Boston in 81. That's now available on iTunes as part of the U2 digital collection. Anyway, the combination of my interest in live and getting interested in technology, I sort of became the guy that you would call saying, you know, do I buy VHS or Beta? Do I buy a Technics turntable or a dual turntable? All those really hard choices. And meanwhile, ended up setting up my first computer in 79. I know I'm giving you a very long-winded answer. I'm hearing it.
But no. Let's talk about the computer.
So in 79, I got an Atari 800. I got a 300 baud Hayes smart modem. And I got a CompuServe account with a number that no one could remember, and nobody that I knew that had an email account. So it was kind of quiet. But later in 82, a very smart man that I worked with at Warner by the name of Stan Cornyn started a digital think group between Warner Records and Atari. And again, through a very, interesting chain of events, Alan Kay, who invented the mouse and the graphic interface, he had left Xerox PARC after Steve and Woz borrowed the idea of the graphic interface for the Lisa and then the Mac. He went over to Atari. He called my boss, Dan Cornyn, and said, when the CD comes out next year in 83, it's going to have a profound effect on the music industry beyond the revenue possibilities. So believe it or not, in 82, we started looking at things like downloading, streaming, burning CDs. But in 85 or 86, a CD burner was $20,000. And a blank disc was, I think, $10. So how could that possibly hurt the music industry, right?
Well, exactly. I mean, that's kind of the start of, you know, how it changed the way that we buy music. And, you know, now it's the subscription model is really in place. And of course, you were a part of, the Napster era.
So what happened was, I stayed at Warner. I was on the committee for a couple of years. We looked at multi-camera video discs. We looked at remixing. We looked at mashups. But in 84, I got offered a job working for Westwood One. A guy named Norm Pattis, who I'd done a lot of work with, offered me to come in and start a video division at Westwood. And I played hard to get for a little while. And then in April of 84, I went to the Beverly Center with the guys from King Crimson, Robert Fripp and Tony Levin, to watch this really funny movie called Spinal Tap. And I ended up at the end of the movie, they said, "What'd you think?" I said, "I think I'm done touring with bands." That movie was basically an amalgam of every band I'd ever worked with. Besides Fleetwood and the Pretenders and The Who and Talking Heads and Prince, I had done Deep Purple, Black Sabbath, Uriah Heep, all these metal bands. And the movie was literally, it didn't go far enough in how bad things could get on the road with bands. So I ended up calling up Norm and taking the job at Westwood. A couple of years later, I started working with Philips Interactive on CDI, which was their proprietary CD-ROM system. And that went from around 87 to 96. We went through $1 billion. And for some reason, Philips in Holland shut us down. Something about spending the $1 billion, I'm not sure. But I ended up consulting. So in 97, I started working with Prodigy, the music service, had about a half a dozen clients. And then I met John Fanning, the evil Uncle John, in early 99 and started consulting for Napster in September of 99, all the way up until May 6th or 7th of 2000, when I flew to Atlanta for an EMI conference that I'd helped them put together, a digital conference, found out that they wanted me to start working there on Monday. Excuse me. And on Friday, I was working for Napster. On Monday, I was working for EMI. And on Monday afternoon, the RIAA sued Napster. So fast forward about 5 years later, I got deposed for 8 hours, 4 hours as a Napster employee and 4 hours as an EMI employee, asking me my viewpoints on the rights and wrongs and the actions of both Napster and the music industry.
What were you telling artists? What were artists thinking at that time with Napster and the, you know, were they worried about their music? Were they worried about what was happening? What were artists saying?
Well, some people, I remember I was with, I'm blanking on his first name now. He was Bonnie Raitt's manager. We were in Emeryville at this compound. You may know what it was. It was called MB2000, but it was this digital entertainment complex that somebody had built in Emeryville. And I had a few people in a room and I said, "Oh, by the way, have you actually seen Napster?" And this was the fall of 99. And I showed it to them And he went crazy, got on the phone, called Hillary Rosen, who was running the RIAA, and said, have you seen this? This is horrible. There were other artists that really liked it. I mean, it was the first time that you could buy in a very fluid way. I mean, it doesn't look fluid now, but at the time it was groundbreaking. You could find the music that you'd be interested in. You could find music that you didn't know you were interested in. So, I mean, there was the possibility that we could change how things were being done. The reality was I went to work for Napster in October of 99 officially. In December of 99, I brought a guy named Bill Bales, who was the interim COO, over to EMI to meet with Jay Samet, who I was then consulting for at EMI, to do a deal to see if we could make something happen. And Jay said, let's try something. So this was, we were in the Capitol Tower up on the executive floor. We go back outside and I said to Bill, this is great news. We can do this. And he goes, no, we just need to stall them for a while till we get copyright law changed. So when you go back and look at the history of Napster, and then I'm going to shut up and take a breath here. when you look at the history of Napster, everybody believes that it was the music industry that screwed this up. If you watch Scandal ever?
I do. I was addicted to Scandal.
Okay, so I'm addicted to Scandal. I think it's a brilliant show. But there was a moment where Kerry Washington, who plays Olivia Pope, says she came to D.C. to work with the white hats and defeat the black hats, and that she discovered that there are no white hats, there are no black hats, they're all gray hats. That's basically where we are with digital music. It's not that the labels and the publishers are wrong and the tech companies are right, or that the tech companies are pirates and the labels are right. We're in this period of uncomfortable transition, and we're going to get through it. But it's starting to settle down. That's what we were talking about earlier. This is an interesting week for music with Apple Music launching, because this could be, for a lot of reasons, intended and unintended, the beginning of some stability in what the future of the music industry is and what the future of the monetization of music for both the traditional business and what it's going to be for artists who are doing it differently going forward.
You know, I want to talk about that. I mean, we talked about how artists perceived Napster in the beginning and what the, especially younger artists who weren't around when things were different and how they're adapting, maybe Taylor Swift, and that's been big news over the last week. Before we do, though, before we get to that, I want to thank a sponsor of Triangulation, which is Prosper. In fact, so here, let's just face it. There aren't a lot of good ways to borrow money. You've got, you know, friends, family, I don't know, credit cards, not a good way at all. And the traditional bank loans, of course. But now with Prosper.com, there's a better way. You can borrow up to $35,000 in just as few as 5 days and use the money for just about anything you desire. In fact, you could pay off your high-rate cards. I mean, we all have them, right? So pay off your cards, fix up the house, even put it into your business, which I highly recommend. In fact, I get a lot of people talk to me about they don't have the money to start a business. Well, this is a great way to do that. I mean, take the leap, whether it's, I don't know, you know, investing in your marketing or whatever that might be. This is a way for you to get that money that you need to do those things. Prosper's online marketplace connects people who need money with those who want to invest in you. Don't rack up more debt on your credit cards. Pay them off with Prosper to check your low rate instantly without affecting your good credit. Go to prosper.com/twit. And now, and for a limited time, Prosper is offering Twit viewers $50 Visa gift card with your low interest loan. That's right. You can get up to $35,000 on your account in as few as 5 days and a $50 Visa gift card. Go to prosper.com/twit for this special offer just for Twit viewers. Prosper is a great way to literally make that big leap. You know, money is an issue for everyone at some point or another, and this is a good way to do that. You don't have to tap into your friends and your family. Go to Prosper and invest. This is for Twit viewers. So speaking of getting invested, you've got new artists who sometimes, in fact, I have a friend who's an artist and she's a very successful career, but she had to dish out a lot of money to get started with her career. And the advice she was getting as a new artist, and she's in country music. In fact, Sandy Wells is her name. She just, you know, went to Nashville. She had to pay to have recording done and that sort of thing. That kind of thing is still the same, but marketing is quite a bit different. And that's where she, as a new artist, has really struggled. And so she wasn't used to being promoted by, you know, radio stations and by, you know, the albums of past. She's got to do this on her own. What is the point of view of an artist today with all of the ways that they have to market their, what they're doing? Are they overwhelmed? Do they like the streaming idea? I mean, what's their point of view?
Well, look, I mean, when I say this stuff, I hear myself, like, because I say it a lot, and I really believe it. There's an artist named Jonathan Brooke, who's a friend of mine. She's married to a friend of mine named Pat Raines, who I first met him when he was managing Al Jarreau. And I interviewed her once, and I said, are you making more money now than you were making before? Because she had been signed to Universal Music. And she said, no, it's pretty much costing me the same thing that it was costing me before, but the label was paying for it. I'm probably making the same per unit, but I get to hire the publicist I want, the promotion person I want, the marketing person I want. So you get to put together this much better dream team than ending up with somebody at the label who possibly doesn't get you. So that part of it's good. The bad part is that you have to come up with that financing. When people say, yeah, but what's the label? It's just a bank. Yeah, it's a bank. And it's a bank with a lot of people that, in a lot of cases, are really, really talented. So you have the luxury. I mentioned Bonnie Raitt earlier. You know, we did 10 albums with Bonnie, and they all did okay. And it was over probably a 10, 15-year period. Ultimately, she left Warner and went to Capitol and had her big hits. But the idea that a label would continue to support an artist through 10 albums, excuse me, when they weren't totally profitable, that doesn't happen anymore. So we're in this period now where your friend has to figure out who's the best person to do her publicity, who's the best person to do her social media, who's a good independent marketing person. Because, and again, I say this way too many times, so I'm like boring myself. The great news is that the music business has become this great level playing field. Everybody has an opportunity now. Most of the gatekeepers have gone away. The bad news is it's a level playing field. How do you stand out? How do you get noticed? How do people know that either her music is different or she has an amazing story that, you know, she grew up on an island in the South Pacific and was discovered by pirates and rescued? You know, what is it that makes her stand out and makes her get attention, you know, and basically be noticed? Because the big labels are still taking some big bets, but even the major label artists right now, they're not connecting the way they used to because the field of competition is so vast now.
You know, you've talked about Nora Jones and how she got started, and that was kind of early on. And in fact, if you're just tuning in, we're talking to Ted Cohen, who is the strategic managing partner of Tag Strategic, and he's at Spinal Tap on Twitter, which if you were listening earlier in the show, he's a big fan of the movie. And so such a fan that that's his actual Twitter handle. The man goes by Spinal Tap.
But I offered it. The funny thing is I became friends with the band, with the guys, with Harry Shearer and Michael Michael McKeon. And I offered to give it back to them because I said, would you like it? Because my personal email address is spinaltap@earthlink.net. My Twitter handle is Spinal Tap. My Instagram handle is Spinal Tap. And so I said to Harriet Wasserman, who manages them, would the guys like it back? I mean, they can have it. She said, no, they're okay. So yes, I'm a big fan of the movie, and I'm a big fan of what I refer to as Spinal Tap moments, and they happen all the time. If you look at the launch of Tidal a few weeks ago of Jay-Z's new streaming service, it was a Spinal Tap moment. He filled the stage with some of the most important artists in the world, and people looked at it like a celebrity fashion show. And so when they're up there talking about they're there to save the poor artist who's been mistreated by the major label, there was probably $100 million in jewelry on that stage. So it didn't turn out real well. So I referred to it, well, there's another good Spinal Tap, incident.
Yeah, well, and I want to get to, services for artists and that sort of thing, as well as like, you know, Pandora and Spotify and what's happening with Apple Music and Google. But I also want to talk about, last night even, you're talking about award shows. BET was last night, the BET award show, and talking about a lot of, you know, jewelry on stage and fashion and the kind of that personal branding. You were a part of that personal branding from the beginning. You worked with some really interesting bands, including Van Halen, which it was the original Van Halen, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
David Lee Roth.
Yep.
Did you see
David
him
Lee Roth
do the splits?
And Michael Anthony? Yes, he did. I've got pictures. No, we had a lot of fun. I did the first 6 years. And I'll do a quick, short story for a change. I went last year to the British consulate here in L.A. over in Hancock Park. And they told me, I didn't got invited. And the guy who was organizing the event said, Sammy Hagar is going to be here. And so I was excited to see Sammy because I'd worked with him. When I got there, though, I looked across the garden in the back of the consulate, and I see Michael Anthony, the original bass player, who had left the band with Sammy to go off and start Chicken Foot. And I sneak up behind him. He's still got his back to me, and I drop my arms over his shoulders from behind, and I wrap my arms sort of loose like a sweater around his chest, and I whisper in his ear, "You don't write, you don't call, you don't take me to lunch." I expected him to turn around, look at me and go, "Oh, Ted," or look at me and go, "You look familiar." Without turning around, he went, "Teddy?" And I got, as Mike Myers would say, I got verklempt. I went, "Really? I haven't seen you in 15 years. How would you know it was me?" He said, "I'd never forget your voice. You woke me up every morning for 6 years to go do radio interviews." So, they were a lot of fun to work with.
Does anybody work with artists that way anymore? I mean, again, you know, it's not really about being on the radio anymore. It could be about being promoted on one of these other services. Is it up to the artist to actually promote themselves? Or is there somebody like you today that helps bands migrate the digital path?
Well, artist development, which was something that, my title was, I was... At the time when I left, I was VP of Artist Development. Actually, no, I was Director of Artist Development. I was about to be. They offered me VP to stay. But we had 12 people. The bands that I referred to, and I was teased with people, they said, "What did you do?" I said, "I went on the road with baby bands from basically 74 to 84. And they would assign each of us a baby band to work with. My baby bands were Van Halen, Fleetwood Mac, Prince, Talking Heads, Pretenders. Another woman who worked with me in my department when I was managing the department was a woman named Ellen Darst. I assigned her this baby band called U2. She ended up leaving Warner Brothers to go to work for U2 as their American manager. So we were really good at figuring out not only what the marketing should be, whatever, when we had great marketing people at Warner, but we had relationships with William Morris and CAA and ICM and would figure out what tour should the band go out on. Should they do a club tour first? Should they do a headlining tour in clubs, or should they be the opening act for somebody else? So like in the case of Van Halen, really quickly, we decided to put them out with Journey as the opening act on a 3-month tour. They killed Journey. Journey could not follow them. They were so good and so over the top that had we put them in rock clubs around the country, while the clubs would have gone nuts, you wouldn't have had 10, 15,000 people every night realizing how brilliant these guys were. So those were the kind of things. With Prince, we put him in pop clubs. When we put him out on the Dirty Mind tour, I was out on it for 2 months. He did the Ritz. I always say we. He played the Ritz in New York, the Agora in Atlanta, the Park West in Chicago. These were all pop rock clubs where R&B acts didn't play because we're trying to get it across that Prince wasn't an R&B act. He was, you know, the child of Jimi Hendrix and James Brown. And there are people like Ron Fell, who you may know in San Francisco, who ran the Gavin Report, who still remarks that he got to go to the Corners or whatever it was on Broadway, by Broadway and right by Carol Doda's club. And he saw Prince in a 500-seat club. And that was the first time that pop people, you know, came in contact. So that was what we did. I don't think anybody does it anymore. But there are some great people out there that do social media, people like Ariel Hyatt, who teaches artists how to do it themselves. There's a guy named Martin Atkins that used to be a member of Public Image Limited, which was Johnny Lydon's band after Sex Pistols. So I had met him on the Public Image Tour. He writes books on basically how to be your own record company, what you need to do. And so if you're willing to invest the time, if you're willing to, you know, look for the right people, those resources are out there. And there's some really intelligent, talented people that can help an artist, build a career. But it's a tough slog. It's not the same. I mean, the whole concept of artist development inside of a label, nurturing a band, goes away. But what it also taught me, and I'll take a breath again, what it also taught me was how to work with startups. So I treat the startups that I work with like baby bands. I tell them when I don't, they'll say, get me on a panel at San Francisco Music Tech at Brian Zisk's conference. And I'll go, no, you're not ready. You're not ready to do a panel yet. You haven't launched the app yet, or you haven't launched the service yet, or you're still in beta and it's not fully baked. You'll do the next one. And they go, what are we paying you for? I said, you're paying me to tell you you're not ready. I don't want you to fall on your face. I'm here to do what I refer to as gun control. I don't want you to shoot yourself in the foot.
I want to talk more about the labels and how they had to transition. And in every industry, you have these, you know, old timers who stick their feet in the mud. They don't want to move forward. And you worked in the space where you really tried to push people, like, are you doing it today? But people get it today. You were at a very part of this transition of the industry where you had to get labels to understand that this was changing. And there were some very forward-thinking labels. There were some that were not. But before we talk about that, Ted, I'm going to give you a chance to breathe and thank, again, another sponsor of Triangulation, okay. And that is Ring Video Doorbell. In fact, over 95% of home break-ins happen during the day. It's my biggest fear is that somebody's going to break in while I'm at work. They're going to see me on air, they're going to know where I'm at, and they're going to break in. And burglars almost always start by ringing your doorbell to see if someone's home before pillaging your possessions. With Ring Video Doorbell, you can see and talk to anyone at the door from anywhere in the world using your smartphone. How cool is that? Ring's advanced motion detection alerts you even if someone doesn't ring the doorbell. It's like caller ID for your home. Installing Ring takes minutes, and it works with either your current wiring or built-in rechargeable battery. Put your mind at ease and protect your home with the video doorbell. Time magazine named one of the top 10 gadgets of 2014. I can't tell you how many times I've been worried about, you know, somebody breaking in. And, you know, there's many times that I don't even just want to answer my door when I am at home because I don't know who's there. Where I live, I can't really see it. So with this device, it's peace of mind. Not only do you not have to worry, like, well, it's never going to happen to me. Well, this is going to give you that peace of mind that you don't have to worry about. In fact, I've seen Leo use it here at Twit when he's the most on-air personality there is. So people know he's not home when he's on air, right? Well, this way he can check to see what's happening. And maybe you want to know it's your family member. Maybe you just want to see that somebody dropped off a package. Or maybe you just want to feel safer. Right now, you can get Ring Video Doorbell for only $174. That's a $25 off the normal price. Protect your home and have peace of mind with Ring. Go to ring.com/triangulation. That's ring.com/triangulation. What a cool device. And I'm so proud to be that they're a sponsor of Triangulation and on Twit TV. In fact, I am getting me a Ring. I have to. In fact, Ted, you and I were talking before the show. You saw Ring.
I want one.
What's that?
I want one.
I want one.
I saw them on Shark Tank presenting it. It's a fantastic product. We're also using, we have Nest Cam in our driveway. It lets us know when someone's even pulled in the driveway, and combining that with Ring, that's the other piece of the puzzle that I needed. So
there you go.
It was worth it doing the show today just to learn that it's finally out. I didn't know it would have been released.
Well, that's because you got to watch more Twit, right? Then you know all the cool products that are out there our show Before You Buy, which you should be watching as well. Okay, let's talk about the mindset of people in an industry. And I've been there with my past and trying to get people to migrate and understand the evolution of the internet and digital. And you have the labels, right, that you're trying to, you have the artists you have to educate. But I think artists are much more forward thinking for the most part than labels, right? Oh, no, he sighs. No, well, was that like? Okay.
So a couple things. I supposedly you like me for the stories, but at any point, cough and I'll stop. So I'm at EMI. And it's 2004, or late 2003, early 2004. iTunes is very successful. They've just done this big Pepsi campaign where you could win iTunes tracks by going to 7-Eleven and buying a Pepsi, and you peeled off the thing. So, excuse me, I get a phone call from a friend at Nokia. And the friend at Nokia says, excuse me, we want to buy 100,000 tracks. We want to put a 10 song scratch off card in 10,000 Nokia music phones. But we want to get a deal from EMI. So what's the best deal you could give us? So I always joke that I'm a Harvard and Oxford graduate, which I'm not. I did some very intense Excel calculations, and I said, I'll give you 20% off. Instead of 75 cents a track, I'll give it to you for 60 cents a track. And the guy goes, okay, what songs can I have? I said, anything that's on iTunes you can use. Then I called a friend of mine and a resource for the company by the name of Shahar Oren, that has a company called Neurotic Media. And I said, could you fulfill these downloads? He said, yes. So I put the whole thing together. But the short part is I realized I could never get this approved through my department, through digital business development, because I'd have to explain too much that nobody would get. So I hid it in an area of the company called Special Markets. It was run by a guy named Eli Okun. They're the people that do the Pottery Barn CDs and the Shell Oil Songs of Summer Beach Boys CDs, buy 10 gallons of gas and get the CD for $5.
Is it the same stuff that the kiosk at like Target or whatever, where you walk by and it's playing music all the time?
They did some of those. So it's what they call Special Markets. It's licensing. So I called Eli up and I said, look, I would have to fill out 30 pages of paperwork to explain why I'm doing this deal. You take the deal. About 8 months later, a guy named Ivan Gavin, who's now COO at Sony Music in New York, works for Doug Morris. He was the COO of EMI North America, calls me up. He's South African, and the accent, I can't do the accent, but the accent's wonderful. And he starts screaming at me and swearing at me, UMF, I caught you. You tried to hide this deal. And he went on worse than I'm doing now. He went on for like 5 or 10 minutes screaming at me. And he took a breath, and I said, two things I want you to know. I don't work for you. I work for London. But I really love your accent, so keep screaming, because it's great. So he screams at me for another couple of minutes. I said, what did I do? He said, you devalued our music. You sold our music instead of 75 cents. You sold it for 60 cents. I said, no, I didn't. He said, yes, you did. I said, no, I didn't. The campaign is over. It ended a month ago. out of the 100,000 tracks that were paid for by Nokia, how many do you think were redeemed? He goes, I don't know. How many? I said, 1,000. He goes, what does that mean? I said, it means that we got $60 a song. He goes, is this a business? I said, yeah, it's called breakage. He's ended up setting up a whole department inside of Eli's group at Special Markets to do digital premiums. We had never done them before. But I had to go around the system to pull it off because I would have had to come up with historical data on something that had no history. So what we got really good at was taking chances on things. And there were people at other labels that were doing the same thing. The guy who took my place at EMI when I left to start Tag was a guy named Barney Ragg. He was doing the same sort of, you know, black ops stuff when he was at Universal. There's a guy that I worked that joined EMI later named Mark Pibby, who's at Sony in New York. I believe he takes chances. Brad Spar, who works for Sony here. Rob Wells, who just left Universal, was a trailblazer. So, again, I'm very defensive about this idea that nobody at the labels got it. Nobody at the labels took any chances. But you're dealing with a historical structure where artists have contracts and they get paid advances and they get paid minimums. And even though publicly they will say, you know, my label is stupid, my label is whatever, privately when you say to them, okay, we'll skip giving you the advance on your next record, we'll put it up on a LimeWire, and we'll ask everybody to pay a buck if they like it. No, 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 give me my advance. So it's a little bit disingenuous.
So, you know, you've been pretty passionate about empowering independent musicians. And, you know, you have quite a stack, in fact, of, you know, how we listen to music today is we're very mobile. You've got, I think, all that on the back of you. Is that all, are those all phones that you have? What is that row?
This, okay, so this row is Motorola.
Oh, organized also.
This,
nice.
This row is Creative Labs. I don't know I can tilt it back a little bit here. This row up here is Nokia. If I go back down here in the jungle of whatever, this right here, and it looks like the Dark Ages.
Are you seeing this, Jason?
This is BlackBerry, including the famous AOL Blueberry.
I hear laughter, isn't it, Jason?
Right. And then we get down here. Here was a groundbreaking device. This was the Intel digital camera back when people didn't think that digital cameras were ever going to mean anything.
Well, and that's a whole nother show, the evolution of our pictures, right? But
yeah, this is one of my favorite devices, the old Sidekick.
Yeah, there you go.
So, yeah, there's a lot of tech here.
Okay,
there's
history a lot of tech behind you.
The third floor is basically every gaming system. It's Nintendo, Coleco, Intellivision, Sega, Jaguar, all the Atari stuff, all the Apple stuff, a bunch of prototypes. It's pretty much been my life and my passion of how technology both empowers you and how it entertains you. And I guess the funniest thing is every once in a while, I would go to make a copy. This is back in early 2000s. I'd go to make a copy of something or I'd go to play something on another device and it would say, you've reached your limit. And I'd go, whose stupid idea was this? And I went, oh yeah, that was my idea. So when I would run into my own limits, it was in very amusing moments. So I started getting about I used to joke that the limits, if they were high enough, when iTunes started, you were allowed to make 7 copies. You could have things on 7 machines. And I would joke that was done for Irish Catholic families because there's large families. You know, it was a Jewish family. It was a husband and a wife and a dog, and the dog never logged on. So I thought 7 was enough, but we still ran into limits.
So let's talk about limits or maybe just access in general. You know, you and I have talked about this is a new era, right? So we've got Spotify. I can find out about music would never have heard of before because somebody's recommending it to me. You know, I follow lists.
What music have you discovered because somebody turned you onto it?
All the time.
Or a service. Tell me something you like.
Spotify.
Tell me music that you found on Spotify, an artist that you like now and listen to that you never found before.
I'm on the spot. I can't name the artist, but I have them on lists. And so,
okay.
So I listen to them that way. But I also listen to, you know, Sirius in my car. I listen to, you know, Pandora, which, you know, I listen to first. I probably listen to a lot more Spotify now than I do Pandora, but I listen to them all for different reasons and in different places. And I do listen a lot on my mobile device or when I'm in my car. So I'm constantly listening to music, but not as much when I'm at home doing other things, unless I'm really busy doing something. And so we have different ways that we're listening to music, and we are discovering new music. But, you know, you seem pretty passionate about it. I think it's almost like, are you challenging me that I'm not finding new artists?
Because
that's a good point. Do independent artists really do they get discovered this way?
Well, the question is this. I think most of the time we want to be entertained. And so the best form of discovery is if I create, I talk about this a lot, that if I create a playlist of music, let's say I pick 10 songs I like, I want Spotify to give me 10 more that I wouldn't have thought of. And in the context of hearing music that I'm familiar with and I'm being entertained, you have that magical moment of hearing something you never heard before, where you go, wow, this is really good. And that's the way I want to get it. I don't know if it's with somebody recommending to me the song of the week. So I'm wondering, through Spotify, I wasn't challenging you, are you finding new music? I was saying there's a lot of different tools on Spotify to find new music. Are you doing it through a recommended playlist? Are you doing it through the song of the week? Are you doing it through, you know, Taylor Swift created a playlist on Apple and she's recommended 5 other artists that she likes?
Well, and that's a really good point. I mean, am I really discovering new artists that are just organically coming up? I mean, does the independent artist have access to being discovered through the way that we listen to music today? I mean, I mentioned a friend of mine earlier who is really not sure what she should do. And she doesn't have somebody that's an artist development expert like yourself back then. Today, I mean, she doesn't really have anybody. She's got her producer telling her, well, you need to go promote yourself. And she's trying to figure out how to do that. So what is the status of the independent artist today?
Well, you want to get, I mean, one of the people out there that is making a difference, this is another company, it's called D-I-G-S-I-N, DigSin. It's a guy named Jay Frank, who used to work at Launch and then was at Yahoo Music with, you know, the unfortunate passing of David Goldberg, Sheri Sandberg's husband. He had started Launch and then went over to Yahoo, sold it to Yahoo and started Yahoo Music. Jay moved to Nashville a few years ago, and he started DigSin. And he is basically doing promotion to Spotify, but in a very above-board way. It's not like the old days of paying an indie promo guy to get your record added somewhere and, you know, something changed hands somewhere. He basically, you reach out to him with your music, and if he finds your music to be credible, he is a trusted source for Spotify to add music to their featured playlists, etc. So, I mean, like I said, he's really good. Ariel Hyatt's really good. There's some great people out there, but you talked about how much hard work your friend might have to do. That's been the biggest disappointment for me, is in the implosion of the traditional music industry, and it hasn't completely imploded. I mean, it still really matters, and radio really matters. Actually, I got an email from iHeart this morning that radio is still the number one way that people are discovering music with everything, and they have iHeart Radio, so they're not saying that people are discovering on an iHeart Digital. They say people are discovering music listening to radio. With all of that out there, artists really have to work hard now. They really do. They have to be part of their career. I stood up last year at South by Southwest. A friend of mine, Dan Steinberg, was doing a panel on how to market yourself. And he said, I'm only taking questions, no statements. And I raised my hand and I said, it's a statement. And he says, I'll make an exception for you. What's the statement? I said, for years, artists would look to their label, their manager, their publicist, everybody, as the people in charge of their career. I said, now it's basically looking in the mirror. As an artist these days, you have more accountability and more responsibility for what happens with your life. You really can't, the idea of blaming somebody else is really come off the table. So you really, it's a business. And whether it's the traditional music business or the new independent artist business, you know, there are tools. I was mentioning to you earlier today before the show, some of the companies I'm working with right now, there's a company called Gigmore that's helping bands find band members. And I went to Steve Rennie's party last night. Steve Rennie does a show called Ren Man Live. And I met these two guys that Maggie, my fiance, brought me over to meet. They're in Columbus, Ohio. They're the two leaders of the group. They found a bass player in Denver, but they were having no idea how to find a drummer. She showed them Gigmore, and they went, this is perfect. And while I was there, they signed up. There's a startup that I'm working with out of New York called HearPlay.com. And it's basically Foursquare meets music. And it, the idea of it is that you end up becoming the mayor of Williamsburg in Brooklyn because your playlists are so cool and everybody's clicking on your playlist because you become the musical tastemaker in Williamsburg or in Scarsdale or in Austin, Texas. So they're picking cities and launching in different cities to help discover new music. I didn't come here to pitch clients, but I mean, this is my passion. The people I work with are companies I'm really excited about. I don't take something on unless I think they're phenomenal or they have the potential. Anyway, there's a company that I met 2 years ago called Jukely, J-U-K-E-L-Y.com. And their original idea was concert listings, similar to Songkick and Bands in Town. And then Bora Selick, the founder of the company, came up with this idea for basically, it's a trite phrase, but Netflix for concerts. So he's launched in San Francisco, in Los Angeles, in New York. He just launched last week in London, and he's in Amsterdam. We had a call this morning. And it's basically you pay a set fee a month to go to a show a night at dozens of venues. And it's actually really, really cool. When he was doing it as concert listings, he couldn't get anybody's attention. He came up with this idea, and it was his idea to go with this Netflix for shows. He's raised $12 million in the last 6 months, including the original investor in Spotify and the guy who's one of the lead investors in buying Warner Records. So there's some great services out there. There's some great tools. There's another one that I mentioned if you want to, so I don't get yelled at. It's hero.fm. I think you grabbed the URL.
So you don't get yelled at by me, not by me.
Not by you, but if a client happens to see, you mentioned everybody else, but not me. These guys are really good at helping indie bands get noticed. And I found some actually great music on here. I met these guys at South by Southwest. I just walked up to them and said, so tell me what you do. And I was really impressed with their response. So I'm working with them and a guy named Jeff Rabin, who is the head of the Clive Davis School of Recorded Music at NYU. We're both on their advisory board and then I'm consulting for them. They're really, really smart people. I tell you, it's the best time for music ever. Yeah, you can roll over and find an artist in your neighborhood there.
Look at that.
And no, it's actually very, very,
that is
very,
very intuitive. Mm-hmm.
It's very cool. So I end up meeting a lot of smart people. And again, I fall into this artist development role of going, you got a great product, but you have no business model, or you've got a great business model, but it's aimed at the wrong vertical. You know, I always talk about, my life has been about girls. So it's all about girls. So I took a girlfriend of mine in the mid 80s. I took her to see a band perform at a club in LA called Largo. And the band plays and she goes, I hate this. And I said, what do you mean? She says, this is the worst country band I've ever heard. I said, no, they're folk rock. And she goes, oh, they're good.
Well, all right.
It's all about context and framing and branding and, you know, it literally, there are companies that have had great ideas that have had to just go back and revamp and figure out, you know, what they need to do to resonate with an audience. I mean, you know Mark Cantor, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, so Mark, you know, Mark was involved early on in Friendster.
Mm-hmm.
Friendster was Facebook before Facebook. Because of just minor tweaks or whatever the timing was or whatever, you know, there are people who were involved in Friendster ago, but we thought of this first.
There's always somebody that you know, yeah, if you think of it, you've got to implement it and put it out there. So I have to ask you about this one. You mentioned some of your other clients, and I'm all about the robot, right, at home. And mm-hmm. You are actually working with the first social robot for your home. Mm-hmm. Tell us about that.
It's really great. I can't tell you exactly what I'm doing, but think about how entertainment would intersect with this. So they came, there's a friend of mine, Dawn Chmielewski from Recode, who I've been friends with since she was at the San Jose Mercury News, became close with her and her husband, a woman named Beth Lasky, who's a really good PR person here in LA, called Dan and said, who in LA should we, besides the obvious candidates, we're coming to LA from Cambridge, who should we show this to? I get this text, I get a Facebook message, can we come over and show this to you? So Beth and Cynthia, who invented this, and Jerry Asher, who was the early angel investor, and a guy named Steve Chambers, who just left Nuance to be the CEO. Nuance is the voice technology behind Siri and all the other voice command things. They all came over to the house. They showed me they put it on the dining room table. It worked fine. And at the end of it, I said, great meeting you. And they said, no, we have some ideas around entertainment. We'd like to talk to you. So we're working together now. I can't tell you exactly what it is, but there are ways that the Jibo could enhance your home entertainment experience.
I want a Jibo.
I do too. Yeah. I said I'd work just to be first on the list. It's like, there's a lot of people, they've already sold close to 100,000 of, I don't know what the number is. I'm confused on what the number is, but the list is long enough that I would give them back some of the money they're paying me to move up the list. But I was kidding. So if you're watching this, I'm not doing that.
I want the Jibo to entertain my kitten, Vitna Venom, at home. I mean, Jibo needs to like talk to her, tell her no, don't get it in the trash, that kind of thing.
Digital cameras like that. I saw one at, I was really upset, went to CES in January and went to this basically Shark Tank on stage event that was done and was upset that I wasn't up on stage helping with it because it was so much fun. And there was one guy who had basically, it was Ring, the doorbell that you're showing, the thing, which is amazing,
mm-hmm.
but it was basically Ring for your dog. It was a video camera mounted above the food dish. And you could talk to your pet and say, come over here. And if the dog was good, if the dog sat, because you could see the dog was sitting, you'd press a button and a Milk-Bone dog biscuit would drop out. So, again, clever idea. And I'm sure there are people that have bought it. There was a company that was able to do a mass spectrometer analysis of anything. You would stick this little probe into Coca-Cola, it could do the Pepsi challenge. You could stick the probe in and it could tell you this is Pepsi and that's Coke and that's Diet Coke. It would literally, for $300, do what used to be $100,000 for a lab instrument on CSI. So it's an amazing time right now. I mean, I'm having more fun than I've ever had in my life.
I know, I follow you on Facebook. You're doing a lot of fun.
One of the fun things I'm having right now, this is the Samsung S. But somebody very creatively and very humorously created a Apple Watch interface for it. So people think that I have an Apple Watch with a steroid problem.
Yeah, it's a bit busy. What do you think about that?
No, but it's the Apple interface. But meanwhile, I can do this. So imagine we were in London a month ago. Maggie and I and a bunch of friends were walking down the street in Shoreditch in the new tech startup area, you know, the Silicon Valley of London. I have a Boombotics speaker, and I think you may be familiar with Boombotics. It's a San Francisco company that it's a little hexagon speaker. It's fantastic. I've got it under my shirt. I'm playing the music off my watch. I mean, another song that is fun to walk to is, believe it or not, so imagine walking down the street and there's five of us and the music is sort of like emanating from around us, but nobody sees a boombox, and I'm doing Taylor Swift and Bang Bang, Jessie J, and Black Widow. What's her name? Iggy Azalea. And it's great. It's great, like walking music. And we got to the tube probably 20 minutes quicker than we would have because we were walking in time to the music. So, I mean, the ways to enjoy music, the ways to enjoy video, there's a guy, I'm not working with him, there's a guy named Wade Fenn, who was the CEO at Best Buy, who has created a Sonos-like device that, again, uses voice recognition similar to Jibo to control your music service. There's amazing stuff out there. Sonos keeps launching great new products. I've got people coming over at 4 o'clock today. There's a company called Deviant, one second, I'm going to find it here.
Well, and I was going to ask you, too, about, like, the Pono player, or I'm an 80s girl, so Sony Walkman. I mean, do we care about the detail or getting music? There you go. He's got his, all right, I think I know the answer to that question. Is everybody going to want one? I mean, is this going to change the way that we want to listen to music? Are we going to be more
Is the portable
selective?
Bag of tricks.
There you go.
Look, the Pono is great. The thing that's frustrating for me is that I had hoped between what Deezer is doing with better resolution music, with what Tidal announced with uncompressed music, Apple has their flavor of it. I was hoping that people would end up feeling the same way about music that they feel now about digital photography. I mean, if you have a Canon EOS, you can take better pictures than you could ever take with a Nikon FE 20 years ago. I mean, the ability to manipulate the exposure, the grain, all that stuff. You now have things like Pono that are amazing. I'm trying to see what else is in here in the bag of tricks.
Well, and then the other question I was going to ask you, which doesn't have anything to do with anything that might be in your bag of tricks.
Right.
But the, I guess, kind of a final question, because, I mean, I could have you on here forever. There's
Just, I was going to say, people don't seem, I'll put headphones on people and I'll say, listen to this. And they go, yeah, it sounds really good. And I go, but this is how you, I mean, I play them Enter Sandman by Metallica. It's brilliant. I mean, so that stuff's happening. But I would really hope that people will care more. And as Sonos is in the living room, and as this company, I was trying to find the card here.
I'd hold one up too, but Leo loves his Pono so much. He took it with him, so we can't cheat and listen to it. He takes the good stuff, right? I mean, of course he does.
You've got the big box. Leo. I have the little box.
Leo has the big box.
Yeah, no, so it's great. I mean, so I think high-quality music is good. There's a this company out of France is making a wireless speaker that sounds better than most things I've ever heard in my entire life. This company is a lot of fun. I got to tell you, this is a friend of mine. I don't work with them. This is called the Charger Genie.
What? Okay, Carson. I hope
it looks like that. It looks like a, a lunchbox.
Uh huh.
Okay, I carry all my stuff in it, right?
Uh huh.
When I get on the plane or when I get in my hotel room, which scares the maids, I go in the bottom. Okay.
I don't want to ask why you scare the maids. Like I don't know if anybody picked up on that, but that was kind of. When you go to your hotel room and scare the maids.
This has a 6-strip.
Nice.
It has 6 outlets on it. Because they come into my room and the Pono's plugged in. And the 2 cell phones are plugged in. And the Boombotics speaker and the Beats pill is plugged. There's literally, like, when I travel, there's at least 10 devices that I carry with me. And I've got them plugged into a power strip into this bag. You know, get this out of the way. I feel like a Ron Popeil now. I'm going to start slicing things.
Oh, yeah. But
it's the best time ever. If you love music, if you love video, if you love digital photography, it's the best time ever if you're a service that's trying to, you know, resonate. So I'm having the best time I've ever had. I mean, that's pretty much it.
You know, Ted, you are always so interesting to talk to because not only do you have a gazillion stories, which is great, but you really do get, you're not that digital pioneer who stayed back in, you know, the days of, you know, time gone by. You've followed the evolution. You were forward thinking with computers and the digital technology and marketing and the whole space to now really be able to work with some really interesting companies that are doing interesting things. And you stay very active in the community. And I love talking with you about this kind of product of music that, and I love music, so.
I love it. Yeah. Thanks very much. I really appreciate this. Thanks for letting me ramble on. I know you've only asked 4 questions in 1 hour. I'm totally
I have a huge list of questions, but this is how it always goes with you.
We'll do it again.
So much to share. Well, we will have to do this again. And I thank Leo for letting me sit in on his show today to talk with you more and educate our fans about what it is that you've done in the space. Thanks again, Ted.
Thanks a lot. Have a great day.
Absolutely. That was Ted Cohen. He is the managing partner of I'm tongue-tied. Tag Strategic. I'm sorry, Ted. Ted, he bows his head. I got tongue-tied. See, I finally had a chance to talk, and I got tongue-tied. Of Tag Strategic. You can find him on Twitter at Spinal Tap and follow what he's doing. He's done some really, really great things, and he's easy to talk to. You can catch him at a lot of big events as well, including probably next year, I'm guessing, at South by Southwest. Who knows? Once you start following him on Twitter, you'll see where he's going to be. You should spend some time with him and learn about what he's doing, because what he's doing is at the very cutting edge of the music industry. He knows who to work with, and he knows he's been there, done that, and he's doing it for the future. So I thank again, Ted, and thanks, Leo, for letting me sit in as fill your shoes, so to speak, hopefully, on this episode of Triangulation. And I want to thank all of our fans for listening. And you can follow Triangulation on every Monday from 11 to 12 live by going to twit.tv/triangulation. Catch all the episodes where Leo talks to some of the most interesting people in all of technology. And I want to thank again, Leo. And you can follow me if you'd like to at Tonya Hall Radio on Twitter. I'd love to, you know, I produce other shows like Before You Buy with Karsten and our new Screensaver show. So if you have some ideas, let me know what you think. Thanks, everybody, again, for tuning in to this episode of Triangulation.